about Camaglio 5-0, and the plan would be that we'll have a maybe not that long discussion, but an open one. Of what we can do in the future. We still have plenty of Camaglio developers and many other very smart developers from different projects around, so we can eventually come up with some ideas. And actually, as you resisted, I still have the last two gifts to give away, an book for Camaglio and an ATA. So those that come with, I don't know, the tricky questions or the, let's say, interesting proposals will get selected and might get them home. So Camaglio 5-0. I have to put this so I can use the remote. It's what we plan to use as numbering version for the next major release of Camaglio, as you know, and you have seen in the first of the my presentation, the first introduction in the yesterday morning. There are quite some releases over the time, and we kind of jump from like our numbering version style is like first is some kind of really important change that we change it from 0.9 to 1 when we kind of had a stable framework and we added TLS, so it was kind of RFC mandatory, pretty much complete requirement, the old initial RFC. Then we jump into 3.0 again because of this 2.0 already kind of been reserved for SER at that time, and we merge with SIP Express Router back into what we called at that moment SIP Router project. Then 4.0 as we complete the merge and we got rid of all these duplicates, and now we thought it's time to look at another major leap in the evolution of the project. It's 15 years, a long journey, I would say. As you could see, people are already changing technology behind their application, like Asterisk. They have a new channel for SIP, and everyone is looking at using new technology out there. Fortunately, C is still maybe the best one for real-time communication and, you know, performance from this point of view, so we are not looking at that. But still, there are new things out there that we would like to incorporate and might make the life easier out there. So actually, I was looking at what happened and I tried to see the evolution, and actually I could identify quite easily what I call here like four eras of evolution. So we had the first, you know, years of SIP Express Router where anyone was really happy with that small config, but everything was like static, no variables at that time. You could still do a lot. Most of the dynamic thing was coming from the database, like username and passwords, but in the config file, you could barely print anything other than just plain text and static text from those functions and parameters there. Starting with 2005, and that was more or less like OpenACR time, we added variables to the core and people started to like them, and more variables are coming, and anyone wanted to have more dynamic control of routing logic with these variables, ABPs, XABPs, and then hash table and so on. So everyone wanted more dynamic tools that they can play wait. Once that was sorted out, and also together with the mobile revolution, we had this kind of focus on asynchronous. So UDP was asynchronous by definition, but later people moved to TCP, TLS, presence, but also mobile world. And then they wanted to park the invite and wait for the push notification to take effect and get a new registration. So we had this suspend, continue, and based on that we ended up with async module and then with event API and also JSON RPC are using the same mechanism of, you know, storing the SIP message, what we call a transaction in memory, and then do some or initiate a trigger to an external application, then let that SIP message in the memory process other. So like you have an invite, you need to wake up the target, you trigger the push notification, but then you process other like registration and you process any other, you know, keep alive. And now that's kind of stable. Of course, always it's a space for hammering and tuning. It's a lot of work, I could say, around this API-based integration with external system, but not only. And as a proof could be that with the latest major release, we had like two independent implementation of an HTTP client. Here we have Federico and Ole, both of them working in parallel, more or less. That means there is an interest on the market for that, and also we had this RTJSON that it's quite useful of like hiding all these rules and just feeding Camaleo with what will be the next hops. Should we do parallel forking, serial forking, how we should transform the header, so all in a JSON format, and then Camaleo will be really like just relaying, taking care of retransmission, rerouting if you had more destination and the first one fails. So I call it like apps, but yeah, you could see it as, you know, API-based routing or integration with other tools. So when we will look at these apps, most of them are, you know, this model of having some data or some document, then having some way of transporting it, and then you need to control these two and get actually what you really want to. And we practically have most of them in place for a long time. In the Camaleo configuration file, you can parse JSON, you can access, you can build new JSON documents. XML as well, we have support for XPath, you can extract, you can update documents that are in this format. And of course, with this transformation, you can do any kind of serialization like comma separated values or these kind of operations. Then the transport, we have the HTTP, JSON, of course, SIP could be also an API layer, as we have this UAC module, you can initiate a new request independent of the one that it's actually received from the network. So you got an invite out from the config file, you can generate a new message to notify whatsoever application server about that. And of course, custom, we have this event API that somehow it's using JSON format if you want, but you can send any kind of data through it and then get it back in the configuration file and the result of it, and then handle it as you want. The control from the admin point of view is the interpreter, so you trigger a notification, an event, and then you receive the data, and then you want to interpret it and really end up in some routing. We have the And actually, this is nothing new. We already have the native one, of course, but then we have Lua, Python, Perl, and .NET via Mono project. All of them are existing for a long time as modules. So people could combine like native Camaleo configuration file with executing Lua scripts, all embedded. So practically, it's not that big delay. And actually, I was surprised to see that it's not a big difference, and I'll have some notes later about. So now it's actually more like this 5G I was put yesterday. It's more like all these tools that are kind of useful, let's make it them more easy to integrate and more expose them easier. So you'll see I'll have the way we did it. It was okay, but it feels like we have to do kind of two times coding for some things, and maybe we can simplify that. So this is actually what we already have. I named this Camaleo embedded interface CAMI, as I call it. So the idea was that allow developers of modules to directly export to this embedded interpreters like Lua Python from their module without need of writing code in App Lua or App Python, which was the case so far. So it'd be more or less like how we did it, do it for the native interpreters. In the module, you have a structure. We say, okay, I want to export this function. It has up to 6 parameters. The parameters could be integer or string. And we have fixup functions for optimizing for those that are familiar with the code. And then at runtime, practically, the parameters were retrieved in this precompile after the fixup, which typically would be like parsing at startup and then evaluating the parsed structure and getting an integer or a string. So it could have been like a string or a variable as a parameter. And then with this fixup, we will framework that we had for a long time, we end up having a string anyhow at runtime, right? Either it is that static string you provide as a parameter in the config file, or it is the value of a value that you provided as a parameter for that function. So actually, there are not really big changes. There is nothing like, you know, the native interpreter is gonna be dismissed. Actually, it's still the main one. It's just that now got the feature of knowing that actually you want to switch to another interpreter at some point. So the core parameters, loading modules, module parameters are staying native at this moment. Maybe with the evolution, we will see how it goes. What's now new, so after you put all these parameters, loading modules and module parameters, you can say now CFG engine, it's Lua, Python. You can even make it native, but that's a default, so it's accepting that value. And then, depending on the value, one of these modules that need to implement the interface for this CAMI will take over runtime execution. At this moment, we have App Lua, which is the one I use most for, you know, when I didn't find enough tools in our interpreter and needed to do some, let's say, crazy apps out there. I was been using Lua, but then I wanted to also provide for like Python, which is, seems to be quite loved by DevOps at least, to show that, you know, it's possible to have it in different languages. In the future, probably we'll add more. But this was just to see that it's feasible and we simplify the life of developers, and then we'll have the same set of functions in Lua and in Python as well as in the native language with some filtering, because of course we have some function, for example, or transformation for doing a split of a string or a substring extracting, while Python and Lua, they already have their own native function. So we don't really need to export ours again for that case. The target will be exporting those that relate to SIP management, you know, manipulation of headers or transport layer and so on. And here it's actually comparing, and you'll see that looks like the same, because practically in Lua we export what we have in our native. The thing is that in the future, you might need to plug here some, you know, new ideas like integration with Twitter, Facebook, Lua, or Python already have their libraries. You don't really need to write now a C module for Camaleo. And doesn't mean that you will have to move your entire Camaleo deployment into using these embedded interpreters. Your load balancer and maybe the main register will still be with native interpreter running. But when you add a feature server, might be easier to implement it with this scripting language depending on the target. So practically, you could see here, this is native language calling a subroute. And here it's practically like calling a Lua function, which you'll see, you can define it as any Lua function. I kind of use this KSR, which is Camaleo SIP routing, as a prefix in this case. But besides some of the main hooks, like KSR request route, all the subroutes, it's up to you to choose a name. So it doesn't have to be this subroute, which is equivalent to route recinit, doesn't have to have this format. It could be XYZ. It's just you call it inside it. We have some tricks done here with the exit. Here we handle the return code. I find also a solution with faking a similar exit, because a typical exit in Lua means stop the application. That means stop Camarilla. Probably you don't really want that. But I found a trick for it. For Python, actually, it was easier because I could catch the exception throw by an exit, and I don't stop Camarilla. I just return back to the interpreter. But again, it's kind of one-to-one relation because, again, it's not doing anything new. It's just the old config file as we had it and the new one. The idea is, if you just need this config, you'll probably is better to use the old alternative. If you need something new, fancy, and we don't have it in Camarilla, makes no sense to write a C module eventually in the short time. If you have discovered that it's a bottleneck, probably you want to write it eventually in assembler at some point. And here it's a subroute again, how we define it in Camarilla. Here you define it in Lua, but it's up to you to choose the name again. I want to highlight that. And then it's pretty much equivalent, and again, the purpose will not be to translate it if you don't need to use something that it's better done in Lua or Python. So here would be the equivalent of the request route part in the previous slides, but it was like comparing native and Lua. Here it's Python, like the request route, and Python equivalent of this subroute. So it would be, again, it's not nothing from the Python at this moment that we could highlight. It was just to show that you can have an easy translation in some cases. In terms of C code, then it's where the simplification comes. So in the past, when we needed to export something to Lua, and I got this Max Forward example, what we had to do as a developer in Lua, in Max Forward's module, we had to export a custom structure. It was up to the developer of Max Forward's module, exporting a structure with pointers to the function that wanted to be exported. And then inside the Lua, that developer had to write this kind of, you know, handling the relation with the Lua interpreter with some specific code. And then if you wanted to have it for Python, we had to do something similar in the Python module. And then practically it got a lot better synchronized, because now Lua has a lot of them, because guys at Crocodile also push it a lot, and also Victor at some point, they exported a lot to Lua. Some guys did it with Python, but is no equivalent of them. So where I wanted to get is like, forget about adding anything to app Lua or app Python for each new function. Inside your module, you'll just to have an export a structure where you put like the module name, the function name. This would be the Camarilla function, and this actually already existed. We just have to put this, and we have this mod register, which is for 6 years or even more in place. This is executed when the module is loaded. It's done by TLS module already, by DB modules to export the database API, so it's not something new. This is just porting this structure to the KME interface, and you are done. I actually was able to implement what we have like Camarilla basic configuration file very easy, because most of the C functions were in the prototype I wanted, because it supports at this moment only integer and string parameters. But it's how we work anyhow from the Camarilla config file. Everything is evaluated as a parameter, either to string or integer. So this is it. So practically, it doesn't mean that, okay, now people focus to writing code to export to Lua or Python. It's actually, you write a C code, then you have this fix up for the native config file, and the one that takes directly integer or string parameters, you can directly just export it, and it will be visible at the same time to Lua and to Python at this moment, eventually other embedded languages in the future. So it's just about simplification. Other suggestion that we collected from the community. So first, it's what I told, because it's already implemented. We are still planning to have a meeting and all. It's eventually working on that to meet and work on things like restructuring the source code, reviewing these modules that probably are not really used, and relocating them if nobody really needs. Getting in place a proper unit testing with ability for more than one person to watch it. Right now we have still all the unit testing contributing long time ago by Henning, if it's still around. And I saw that Miko was also adding some new unit tests to it, but I would like to get into a framework that allows many to watch the results and actually administrate it. Then reviewing the building system and see if our old make files still make sense. And eventually not replacing it, but I fear that we have like some conditions there for very old GCC version, like 2. Something that probably we can simplify and then would be easier to maintain the new version. And of course, adding new features. Even here, there are two people approaching me of adding new modules. So two new modules, I got aware of them right now. There will be a couple from other, and already a couple of new modules on the trunk. So to see that's real, again, that was the main work I tried to do before this event, to show it's possible. Right now, if you want to play a bit with this Lua, Python, and native and compare your config file, maybe it's simplifying to some level, you have full configuration file. You can, they are in the source tree of Camaleo already, and you can play and run, I don't know, testing and also compare performances, which I actually did, and I was surprised to see that Lua and native will not be big difference. Again, when we'll start adding, or you'll start adding like native Lua function, that might be a difference. But actually this KME interface doesn't add any kind of overhead in terms of performance, because anyhow Lua kind of compiles to C anyhow as the interpreter, and it's fast. Python was a bit slower, but not as I expected, and not being a big Python developer or not even a fan of that. The only thing I discovered, because I was not the implementer of the Python module in Camaleo, someone contributed like 5 years ago and I was working on that. Because Python is intended to be all object-oriented, inside the module they actually create a C message object, a Python object. So then they need to copy the message and some fields around it, and that takes some operation for sure. So still some of that delay might be from Python, but for sure some of the delay is introduced the way the module is designed. And now here would be the open discussions, and you can now propose, say what's missing. We have many developers. I got this room for 24 more hours, so ready to go. But really, we'll try again to meet eventually, either in cloudy Spain or Portugal or sunny Sweden. Or somewhere else, to get together a couple of developers who is interesting and try to synchronize. At least some of this work is gonna be like more, you know, doesn't require a lot of, you know, heavy work from the point of view of, you know, writing code. Would be more heavy work in terms of grepping and replacing all includes for this relocation of the files and having a nicer structure for the source tree. So you can eventually join, and you don't really need C code skills. It's fine to be just with set Perl or Python, those tools that are good at upgrading paths in files. So I have a question from Alex.
Yeah, so it's a pretty cosmetic objection, but readability is an important consideration when doing this. And what I've noticed in the Lua configs as well as the Python is, you know, you have this endless kind of laborious KSR prefix everywhere, and some of the function names are quite long to begin with. Do any of those languages or interpreters offer some sort of namespacing which can be used to containerize this?
That was only my choice of names, because besides, right now there are two. So we still miss the event routes, but right now it's only the request route and the equivalent of request route and reply route that have that must have a fixed name. Everything else you can just name it X, Y, Z, each function, and even the failure route. We don't have any more the equivalent of failure route. When you say T1 failure from Lua, you put there the name of a Lua function, and that function, it's up to you how you call it. Yeah, like a callback. So you just set a callback, which is a Lua function and could be any kind of name. So this is no longer like, you know, you'll have failure route or branch route. This is, that was a naming policy, but with this embedded interpreter, it's up to you. Dan, still?
All right, as a follow-up to that, Andrei Plinescu on Chul yesterday brought up the issue of performance of Lua versus the native interpreter. What are your thoughts on that, and you know, how can we approach that problem?
So, in the past, I have to agree that probably made a big difference. But right now, and again, here I speak about the latency added by this interface. You know, maybe a library in Lua, it's written by my mother, and if you use it, might be slow. But this is now like really no penalty, like having it from Lua to Python. Of course, we haven't really tried all the function. It was this Camarillo basic that does authentication, registration, attacks detection, and so on. So a fairly good set of features. There are, of course, when you write C code, then you can optimize it for your use case. But anyhow, we still have this kind of dynamic evaluation of the parameters. Like if you want this, like its tail number, which takes a variable or a string number and check if it's only digits, eventually starting with plus. If it's a variable as a parameter for that native function, at the runtime, it's another C function evaluating the variable. But in Lua, there is no extra function. It will be you putting the variable, which will be a Lua variable, as a parameter to this function exported by the Camarillo. So still, we got rid of a layer, this evaluation of the parameters, and now you rely on Lua Python to give you the value, and they will give you on the stack as a pointer, and from there you take it. And again, yeah, in many cases, I'm sure I will still stick with the native, and I will write native functions for optimizing some cases which are really heavily used. But I don't feel myself right now like writing a Facebook client, because some people wants to integrate with Facebook to send, I got a missed call, and put it on the Facebook direct notification or direct Twitter message. Because that would be anyhow like application. So this is more about application. I think we solve more or less the SIB routing part performances. Still to add there, here it's more like enabling more feature that could be attractive for some customers or could be new ideas for new people. And no need to really go down to the C coding. You can look at it a bit as, you know, WebRTC that tries to hide the complexity of all these low level and giving the access to broader set of libraries and features. But again, this one actually, it's not like if you add a function, it's automatically visible in all of them, native, Lua, and Python at this moment. Because even for adding to Lua, you have to write the C code. So it's no change. It's just allowing you that between the function we write in Camaleo, you can use function from Lua and Python or other interpreters.
Okay. So do you have the philosophical intent to create higher levels? Since you used the WebRTC metaphor, I thought, do you have the intent to create some higher level abstractions that wrap this? Because as I see it now, it's a kind of one-to-one correlation to the Camaleo DSL. Yeah.
Probably it was not really like the best analogy in this point of view, but thinking like, you know, getting C developers might be really hard soon. And then it's not about, you know, still this heavily performance SIB routing will be there, but will be about this kind of features for real-time communication, including messaging. It's quite a lot, like, you know, looking at the message and seeing that it's talking about Git, and you identify that, and then you attach a link to the commit, you know, all this Slack stuff could be eventually done easier in Python or Lua comparing with Camaleo transformation and so on. Of course, you can do it, but you'll have to jump into the C. A lot of them you can do it now with transformation and so on, but eventually some crazy ideas are not yet possible with the native one. So it's more like what I wanted to get rid first was re-implementing for each new function in Python and Lua all these long wrappers, as you could see. Now we have an abstract layer that we retrieve from Lua Python, the parameters, and then we provide it to Camaleo directly.
So I'm curious, and maybe to clarify, what's happened when with parsing functions of parameters in modules? Does it execute every time when we goes through the script, or it's once?
Well, right now the parameters are parsed at startup. We have this fix up, so if it's a variable, when you export a function to the Camaleo config file, you say this is a string, and then behind the string you can have a fix up, which parses that at startup, but that it's changed into a structure. If it's a static string, could stay like that string already, or if it's a string with variables, what actually parsing means, okay, I identify first it's some static text, I'll make that element, the first element in this parameter, it's a static string. Then it's a variable. And so the second element, it's like a callback for that variable. Then maybe another static string and variables and so on. So this parsing is done at the startup, but then at runtime, evaluation is done. Because if you put request URI for each call, it's a new one. So we have this evaluation that is done at runtime. It's just this part of parsing is not done at runtime. Although we have some functions that do always parsing, like we have this double evaluation of the variable. So you can have a variable that has as a value another variable, and you want to get the value of the second variable. Michael.
How is nil handled?
Sorry?
Nil? Null? In Lua?
Null in Lua, now we have a function because that's only for our variables. So exposing these pseudo variables, then if you want to check if it's null, you'll have to use is underscore null and the name of the variable, because they have their null or nil native, and we cannot mess with that easy.
Do you have any plans, or are there opportunities to supplement or replace the functionality of AVPs using language native constructs?
Not at this moment, and I think it will not be that easy. A lot of modules are using them internally, but yeah, I saw Victor here did a lot of work with XAVPs, exporting them to Lua as a hash table.
Yes, metadata.
Dan, can you give a mic to, sorry?
In Lua, we already have the functions to translate from XAVPs to metatables. That's object in Lua. So it's easy to just get the values and go from the metatable to the XAVPs too. So the functionality is already there.
So I think my my role somehow finished with making the framework, but then it would be the writers of the modules that will export it. The idea was to make a unique framework that you export once, visible everywhere. So we might even integrate it better with the native exports. Now I didn't want to change that part to, and we have this fix up, so I added like a second export structure via mod. And actually it's why I haven't added a second exports. I use this mod register function, not to add two export structure. But again, it would be, you have a C function, integer and string parameters, which is anyhow the only one supported, and then you can have a wrapper for the config file and a direct export to the Lua and Python. So it's deduplicating the effort of writing for each embedded interpreter.
I just want to say that actually testing in Lua is quite easy. You can just create your fancy idea and then just mock whatever you want, and then you are focusing on just getting the tests. And this is quite easy. In Lua, in C, it's not so easy, in Camaleo. So we already discussed about how can you mock the interactions with the network. In if you can just skip all that and then just test your part. So you can just test your application faking that you receive a register or whatever, invite or whatever you want. And it's easier in Lua to test it from my point of view.
Yeah, and immediate effect right now it's that you can reload Lua script without restarting Camaleo. So practically, if you need to change adding more logging or adding authentication because you forgot and things like that, you just issue a RPC command. Of course, if you need to change the what modules needs to be loaded, then you'll have to restart because you still have the native part. But then the active part at runtime, you send an RPC command and that's it. It will be reloaded. I'm not sure about Python because I'm not involved in that. I just added a framework there and I saw. Yep.
Do you have any benchmark E numbers as to how much of a performance hit either Lua or Python
is? Yep. I actually put it on the wiki. Lua and native is the same for the same configuration file. But again, you can add in the Lua script something. And Python was like 100 milliseconds more. So with Python and this Camaleo, it was like around 2,500 requests per second that could be handled. And with Lua and native was 3,000 per second.
Do you have limitations on what?
Per process. Per second per process, and you have more channels. Okay.
Do you have limitations on what you can use from the Lua environment, such as being able to use outbound sockets, outbound like HTTP requests, et cetera?
Well, that lower layer, like sending, retrieving, is not yet there. It will be more like, so transport layer is still native in Camaleo. It will be more the upper layer of application and routing decision rather than controlling the transport. I was looking at some goodies that eventually you can get. For example, Lua has also coroutines, this kind of light threads, which could be interesting for increasing further the performances, eventually sending log messages in a coroutine, because that doesn't mess with the global variables. But again, we don't really expose the lower layer. It's just what's now possible in the config file and allowing you to use other tools for making a decision or where to send or, you know, these extra applications. And again, we have a lot of developers here. It's maybe time to suggest some new features or at least what we are missing that badly. We have Matthew.
So this is kind of more of a question, and it may end up being a whole lot of people in the room telling me, just don't try to do that. So take this with a big grain of salt. One of the things that we like to do is try to use some sort of centralized logging for our infrastructure. And so all of our Asterisk logs, Camaleo logs, whatever else are getting fed into something. In our case, the very de facto standard of the Elk stack. And I've personally found that I hate writing grok filters. I think they absolutely suck. And as a result, I actually ended up adding to Asterisk recently in master JSON logging, just so I can get raw JSON out and I don't have to parse the damn thing anymore. When I looked at Camaleo, I really couldn't find, and I actually thought about writing a module for this in Camaleo, but I really couldn't figure out if that would even be a good idea, or would even be acceptable. So I have, like, you know, to quote Alex, I have artisanally crafted JSON in my config, right, to dump it out, and then I do just enough grok filter parsing to get rid of it. But sort of just an open question: is this a bad idea? How are y'all handling? You know, if you do centralized logging, how are you handling it? Are you running a bunch of grok filters? Would a JSON logging mechanism of some sort be appropriate for Camaleo?
Well, yeah, you know, if it's a contribution, then the answer, we will accept it from extent. But then, yeah, we actually work a bit on this logging framework recently, and now you can change from the native syslog. You can switch to systemd logging, which sends more information from the environment. Still, the message will be the same, but, you know, it adds more than what the user wanted to print. And also, I implemented a basic one, like you just get the end result of the message, because it could be with variables. So you get the message that the developer wanted to print or the config wanted to print. And right now it's just sending it out through the UDP to show that's really just like hello world of the new logging framework. Probably you can hook in the same system and put that as a JSON and then add whatever extra information you want to add in extra fields. But it's kind of now you can plug in a new module and it will take care of the transport for the log messages.
Logging framework in?
Now it's already in 4.4 actually. So if you look at the new modules in 4.4, will be log underscore syslog and log underscore custom, which will be that basic one that might be the easiest to look at. New features, what's missing? Mr. Ole wants to code tonight. He's a developer.
Yeah, it occurs to me that the one big thing that is missing in Camaleo is...
we have IPv6?
No, not IPv6. full HSS functionality. We already do the SIP authentication.
So but that's SIP?
Yeah.
Well, no. Okay, next question.
But no, you're not doing the full HSS piece with the...
Maybe talk with Karsten, those guys that I do IMS. I'm not much into the IMS. I'm more like core of the Camaleon Foundation. But maybe in the future, I'll see me more there or more in Lua or more in whatever. So it's a matter of the...
Well, the way I look at it, I've got a really big chart of all the 3GPP building blocks on my wall behind my desk.
Yeah.
And I've drawn a big ring around all the bits and pieces that are Camaleo. And, you know, it's getting bigger and bigger, and...
Yeah, I understand, but, okay, I don't really want to make a promise, but more like a consideration. When Steve can use IMS for its home and have access to the network, we'll consider implementing an HSS. Because now it's not a commodity to really implement it. As you see, people do tricks here with Faraday Box to get the native...
Besides that chart, he has a big box filled with gold coins.
Okay, so yeah, I'm really available for... No, but again, IMS is not something that you really could play easily. You can do it, but you need a lot of resources and you need...
we've got most of the other bits and pieces in some form or another. It's just that last little bit of the central authentication piece.
Could be,
and we do most of that already with the SIP authentication, so it's not a huge step.
Yeah, further. But for me, I don't have any IMS testbed. If you can send me a couple of cells with a couple of...
yeah, well, you might not have, but I'm sure Marius and Dragos have.
Then there are supposed to be many developers and eventually in front, so you need to turn it the other way. It's still Karsten around or the other guys, I'm not sure, they run when you say that. Dragos might be outside, but...
You can do it in Lua, I know.
Yeah, that's what I expect. And there you are, you get dragged down into the debate about Lua versus Python, and I'm thinking...
Well, no, we'll add JavaScript.
No!
And now I'm serious. Erlang, we have sealed in there, right? Erlang will be morning or Monday? Mm-hmm. Monday, okay.
COBOL, please.
COBOL? Okay, you are on it for it, Alex, COBOL Tuesday?
If you want to see any of the insanity of embedded languages, just look at, unfortunately, how many FreeSwitch now has. We even have a basic interpreter. Everyone still says use Lua.
Yeah. Now it's more about showing that it's visible in many places at the same time. I have two microphones now, so speaking now.
But don't give it to me.
So again, it was about simplification because a lot of things will stay native, I'm sure, and will not affect at all because it still requires writing C code, and that means it's available for native interpreter. So we have James now working on HSS with his big team. Anything that we should do, and by the way, for Alex, might be interesting, this new Topos module that is still like early phase, but it's intended to be like, because I'm saying I had already two other guys asking about it. It is like a kind of stateful firewall for headers, so translation of the headers in the terms translation from a header to nothing, actually. So you can remove via headers, and then they will be added back for the reply. You can look at it as a back-to-back user agent, but that's something is more like topology hiding by stripping headers, and will not do more than that.
Do they still write in an encrypted fashion in a record route writer? Or?
No, that's the old module. There is a new one with S at the end, topo S, which is the old one was topology hiding, and the new one is topology stripping.
So it just lives a state in memory? It doesn't
right now, it's database. The plan would be to use eventually Redis and so on, because I didn't want to do much of caching in memory, as you need a bit of a distribution between for high availability and so on, and using Redis.
So using an RDBM backend is mandatory at present?
At this moment.
Okay.
But again, but it was not big noise around it because it's still early phase. It's working. I need it for the deployment with instant messaging. I wanted to avoid storing and forwarding, just forwarding without putting further the contact via and so on, and still working. I got calls working, but then you have to test again all the suite with call transfer and so on, parallel forking, serial forking, but the basic framework of stripping the, hiding the topology by stripping the headers, it's there.
I think that's really the wrong way to go. We need to expand headers. We need to add so much information so UDP is impossible. And then we need to add private information in all those messages so people will require TLS. Stripping and compressing and gzipping, bad move. Kill UDP.
I was all against it, but then the project I work on was on privacy and not disclosing the source. And that was the only reason, because the one that receives it can decrypt it, because I don't, cannot read the text. And then if it can track the hops, then it's leaking the information about the sender. That was the only reason. Otherwise, I'm probably the last one to approach about SBC and so on in networks. But it's why I actually did it as a firewall kind of concept, which everyone uses firewalls because they are very useful, rather than trying to do different approaches. So that was the only concern, having protecting the sender from the receiver, which you can also use for spam eventually. Okay, If not, other question, I want to say that on the mailing list, it's active community, come there and propose. Again, it's 5-0 and looks like big changes, but otherwise it's really like continuous evolution. It's not like rewriting from scratch. Actually, for this KME, I didn't really touch the existing module much apart of adding this export structure of existing function. And I wanted to, I was actually considering to doing a bit more automatic, but I didn't want to really mess the native interpreter from the beginning. But otherwise, it's just, you know, getting it up to the current eventual needs of more apps and integration with other systems, and also getting it to the current style of formatting the source tree, and that would be no coding, just replacing. That's about 5-0. It's not like, okay, we're rewriting from scratch now in Rust or something like that. Because I think nobody has like big issues with scalability and features. It's just going into more commodity for developers, as well as developers that are not C coders, but they still want to get into the real time with new ideas. If not, I think we are done and a bit late, but again, we still have 23 hours here if you want. A big thank you for you attending, and of course, our sponsors again, last shout for them, including the video recording here that resisted. And they were also last year, so hopefully they will come in the future with this nice tools around. Alex, Sipwise, Sipgate, and Digium, Matt, thank you for coming all long way. And actually this year we had quite impressive participation from USA and Canada, more than the last years. Of course, South Africa, you need to give a shout. It's a bit exotic. Although we had also Australia a couple of years ago. But I think at least I'm happy that I didn't get that bad reports, but I'm still waiting for them. You can send it via email because we try to improve. As you could see, it's more like, you know, everyone is at the same layer, everyone in the small space, try to get everyone chat with each other. It's more like for community rather than for business purposes. Of course, this shows that the environment is solid and it's a project suitable for really big deployments. So again, I think you are the ones that made the events, because I can organize and I can be alone. That makes no sense, of course, even I would be a good organizer. So thank you for coming, and I'll see you at other events, and eventually 2017, next Camaleo, and of course 2021, 20 years of Camaleo. Book that now. Thank you.